much better than using set attribute, get attribute. But the downside of this approach is that even to change only the 3 or 4 vertex colors, you have already copied the whole array. And that makes it also not so efficient. So the ultimate way of solving this problem is then to use this function, request field ref and release field ref, which sounds a bit awkward, and but it's actually not that hard to understand. So request field ref gives you the real array, so as an object reference in JavaScript. And so in that case, I would do, if I want to change 3 or 4 vertex colors, request field ref, I get the reference to the real array, then I would manipulate it, and then I need to be aware that I just changed X3DIMM's internal representation. So you have to handle that with care. And if you have done your manipulation, you do release field ref, and in that case, X3DIMM, so in the example case which I just mentioned, X3DIMM would then finally sync that data with the GPU, because you just get a CPU copy that X3DIMM internally holds in that case. So you can also find this on the documentation page, but I think it's definitely worth mentioning it at that point, because it really can give you a huge performance boost. In fact, if you think about the example that I just mentioned here with the multipart node, you could also do something like that on your own if you would know, okay, vertices 22 to 42 are the ones that are used for that house. Then I could also do request field ref, manipulate their colors, and I only color that house that way. So I could do fancy stuff like that on my own. But then it would be really important to use those more efficient values than using the DOM manipulation. Yeah, as I mentioned in the beginning, we have in X3DIMM the possibility to use mouse events like on click or on mouse move on 3D shapes. As an alternative to the more traditional X3D way of doing it, which would be via touch sensor and route nodes, or that are not actually nodes, routes in the markup. And using mouse events is much more intuitive if you come from the HTML world and you know already something about web development. Then I think this is a pretty intuitive way of specifying your interaction. And we added also one thing to link both worlds, which is the on-output change event. And you can use that for anything that produces routable output in X3D. So for example, if you are not familiar with the concept, just a very simple example. You have a time sensor, and you link the time sensor to something that interpolates some transformation, and then an object will rotate or move or whatsoever. But if you just want to grab output from the time sensor, which you could, of course, also do somehow different in JavaScript, but it's just an example, then you could add the on-output change event. So it's just an attribute, like on-click or whatever. You just add on-output change equals and then your function to the time sensor node, and you get your function called each time the output of the time sensor changes. And you can do that for any nodes that produce routable output. So you can think of that as a hybrid way of using X3D nodes to produce routable output, but processing it yourself in JavaScript, if you have any use for that. But also, there are also tutorials about that on the X3D page. Yeah, mentioning the page, we just did an update and we have a new examples portal with version 1.7. So this is maybe interesting for you because On the one hand, you can browse the examples here in a very simple way. So you can search for categories like everything that has to do with light and shadow or whatever. You can also, of course, search for names. And you really have a structured overview of the examples, then featured examples, which are a bit more shiny, and then tech demos. And it has always been an issue in the past when people opened the 3JS page and they had this really awesome gallery of nice demos, and then compared that to the X-Freedom page, where it was a bit cluttered and you saw some things called examples or demos that mostly consisted of a box that says, "Hello, I have a box," when you click it. So that's not very spectacular. And I think now we have a better basis for that. So we have this line of featured examples, which is used to showcase some things that are really cool. And although I think those are really cool, it could get even better. So if you have some really shiny X-Freedom example with a good design and nice assets and ambient occlusion baked into textures and whatever looks good, then really feel free to notify us and we can link it here or even put it on our server. And also we have now a mechanism to add examples in a very simple fashion inside our content management system, so it's really not hard to add content there. And by the way, there are already a bunch of examples that do not come from Fraunhofer IGT, but from other people. So really feel free to submit something if you have something really shiny and nice. We'll be happy to showcase it. And we can also put that on the news page as a blog post. It's another possibility. That's one of the new features in X-Freedom 1.7. It's maybe not that spectacular. The common surface shader node now also supports object-based node maps. So I'm just mentioning the latest developments. Implementing tangent-based normal maps is more complicated, and that was already done before. So before you could already use tangent-based normal maps, but there are some tools that just give you object-based normal maps, and if you directly want to work with these and use them, now you can do. So very simple. Okay, so I'll now come to latest discussion and what's going on in the X3D world and the connection to X3D. So as a proposal for the next X3D version, which will contain some HTML or web profile, we propose to integrate the DOM events like on click and so on, so it's more intuitive to use for web developers. We also propose to include the external shape and external geometry nodes into X3D because we think they are a very simple and generic way to include external 3D meshes, just like you include images. So for example, in the image texture node, you can have just URL, and the URL can be myimage.png or myimage.bmp or JPEG or whatever. And if your browser supports it, it will just work. And we have something similar in mind for the 3D objects. So we could have an external shape and it could point to a GRTF file or SRC file or maybe even a Colada file or whatever you have. And the matrix transform node, I already mentioned it. We want to get that into this X3D standard. And also things like the line sensor, which was already proposed because plane sensor is not sufficient for some use cases where you want to realize typical 3D coordinate frame that you use to drag an object around. It's a very typical use case, but if you use plane sensors for that and you are interacting orthogonal to the direction of one of those arrows, you will have pretty weird effects. So we propose also to include a line sensor node, and then finally the common surface shader, because it enables stuff like normal maps, specularity maps, and also displacement maps, and a lot of more recent, not even recent, shading algorithms. The next steps would also include a refinement of the HTML profiles. On X3DM page you find an HTML profile that is a subset of X3D, and this needs to be refined, so there needs to be some cleanup at least. And then regarding the X3DM nodes, that should go into X3D, and we also need to make clear which nodes definitely need to be supported in the X3DM subset of X3D. So this process is not really defined yet, but it should be discussed, and also on the X3D mailing lists and on the X3D list. Okay, so that were, I have 9 minutes left, so thanks for your attention. Is there some questions?
I have a question here. Yeah, are there any kind of developments on the viewpoint, thinking it's kind of an important thing, camera being able to manipulate very well the position and orientation, and being able to collect that information quickly as the user navigates. What would be the most efficient way to do it? I'm thinking to make a decision of the, maybe like a very, for example, a very large data set, you may want to consider the position of the viewpoint to dynamically generate subparts of the X3D of the data set. So in that case, you need to know, as the user navigates, you need to know very quickly the position and the orientation of the data.
Yeah, so there is an on viewpoint change event in the X3D runtime. So in JavaScript, you can catch this event.
Yeah, but it's the frequency of doing that can affect the frame rate. Eventually.
So you want to do it every second frame or so?
Even faster. I mean, to be able to make a decision based on the position.
I think it's right now it's hard to do it in a higher frequency than the rendering, because navigation and rendering are somehow interconnected. And
well, that's right. Yeah. The collecting the information of the viewpoint, the position of the viewpoint, for example, as the user navigates, is there another way, or you just have to basically interrogate using JavaScript?
Yeah, so if the user navigates, the view matrix changes.
Yeah.
And at that point, you get this event, I think. I can look it up, but I think that's the way. So you get these updates whenever the view matrix changes, and you can use that to do whatever is necessary. I think it was already used by some people from our AR department that were doing some fancy stuff, and then they needed a few matrix at each point in time.
Can you have maybe some examples where X3D is loaded with the data set based on the viewpoint position?
Yeah. So I'm not 100% sure, but I think it should be the case in that example.
Even things like changing while for example, the vertical field of view, the angle, that's not possible actually.
I'm not sure, I never tried to change it during runtime.
Yeah, because at the camera parameters, if you could actually change that at runtime, would be something interesting.
Yeah.
So it would automatically affect the whole scene.
Yeah.
You usually try to change the scene, but actually you can make some changes in the camera that will affect how you see the scene.
Yeah, that's true.
And then you can save some time there, like optimize quite a lot by leaving the scene unchanged, or just change the camera parameters maybe.
Mm-hmm. sure what happens if you update the view, the field of view, for example.
You get some distortion. You should get some distortion.
Yeah, but I mean, regarding the culling,
yeah,
I guess it would work. The culling should still work, and, but I never tried to update the field of view during runtime, so we should check.
Yeah, so you can pull some examples and play more with the viewpoint. Mm-hmm. You pull viewpoint parameters, you know, getting the, you know, changing the frame rate.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, thanks for the suggestion.
Still have it here, or did you change the whole repository?
No, no, actually they should all be there, so that are just, the links should also remain valid. All right. So that are just the same things, just ordered a bit. So it might look less, but it's because it's three columns here.
Okay.
I think so. Should everything should be there. If not, just write an email, but I think everything should be. So, any other questions? Yes.
Is there any update related to volume rendering tools?
There have been updates in 1.7. I did not mention them here, but you can maybe. I mean, if you're familiar with this and have already worked, you can just check what has happened on the homepage and on GitHub. To be honest, I'm not so familiar because this volume rendering component is a contribution by Becomtech from San Sebastian. So these guys are doing a great job in maintaining it. And I think that they have done a lot of fixes and corrections in this styles. You know, there are these different volume rendering styles and they have worked on that, but I'm not familiar with the details and what has happened. But there is something new in 1.7.
Thank you.
Okay.
We recently had a discussion here at the conference on the problem of data capturing, creating more and more dense point clouds, and the problem of visualizing these. So do you have any plans in this direction? Because I think when it's predominant, the point cloud is not really supported.
There have been demos, but with reasonably small data sets. So really doing something out of core, out of browser, whatever you call it, with point clouds, I think there will be no contribution from our side to X-Freedom. We are working with the, such data sets and aiming to support them as part of the Instance 3D Hub architecture. So there is also a renderer and Instance 3D Hub who, that should do it. But for X-Freedom, this open source framework, I don't think it will be made available. But we can talk later on if you're interested.
I'm interested in that too.
Okay. I mean, we have this Instance 3D Hub flyers, so that could be a starting point. You at least have a homepage and a flyer and something. And of course, you can talk to me and or to Johannes, our boss, who also presented the Instance 3D Hub paper in the second session this morning.
The reason being that you get most of the raw data as cloud points.
Mm.
You know, so it's like the first step, you know, you hit by millions of points, you know, I mean you can do some processing, but
yeah.
you know, we'd like to have some kind of way to render these parts of it in an efficient manner. Say a million points, you know, to keep up.
Yeah.
A frame rate.
A million points, I mean, depending, at least on the GPUs I have worked with, so nothing really special. It's easily possible to render a million points.
So, give you the concrete example we are looking for. We does it as companies, city of Heartland. So they survey the city now with a 1 centimeter length point cloud. All the facade, and they said with their experience on web-based point visualization, they reduced point cloud to 2 million points. That worked fine, but they have 200 million points.
Yeah. Then you need some smaller algorithms,
exactly.
There's been a cool presentation that basically told us how it can be done, right? With this octree representation. But that's nothing that is inside X3DM and will also not be part of. Will be part of our instance 3D hub architecture, which is, I think, also free for use for non-commercial purposes, but we need to check that then with Johannes.
I have a quick question on, well, it's related with this. I understand that in Germany, most of the cities already have a lot of data. Is it how do they generate the data for the city models? Is it who's in charge? Does anybody know?
I would forward that question to Volker.
Yeah, is the government in charge of acquiring the data and owning it? Is it public data? Because I've seen some of our presentation in the other session where people are using like gigabytes of data, terabytes of data, and I mean, how do you get the data?
It's not an easy answer. So the data is usually available, and in Germany we have a federal structure, so the states have different policies on how to deal with this data, so they usually don't like to share their data for free.
Uh-huh.
Some have different opinions, so Hamburg has made their data set available as open data, Berlin has open data, and Berlin is an interesting example because the city of Berlin, or the state of Berlin, has no 3D city model, but the 3D city model of Berlin is the most published model in a way, but it's owned by a private company. So, but that's a rare case. So usually the data is owned by the government or by the municipality,
and
it's not shared for free. So you can get it for research purposes, usually for free, but it's not open data in most
cases. But how do they acquire the data? Is it a kind of flyby with a radar, or is it cadastral data only? I mean,
it's usually a mix of seven different ways on how to capture data. So in Baden-Württemberg, for example, it's cadastral data plus airborne data scan data plus aerial imagery plus terrestrial laser data from time to time plus terrestrial.
So I'm assuming there has to be some body, some company that has to orchestrate collecting all this data and merging it somehow, right? Is it a private company or is the government doing it?
The German organization of surveyors is defining the data product, and then they develop the specification, and then they have tenders, and companies can bid for the capture. But the specification of the content is usually done with this national organization of surveyors. So they define the rules, basically.
Because I was curious how, you know, if I want to model a city in Romania, for example, how do I go about doing it the easiest way to do it? I've seen Google Earth, if you have checked maybe the last Google Earth street view, they went away from the, if we have Google Earth actually, they went away from the picture mappings on sites, you know, simple kind of canyon style, and they moved to a kind of point model, point cloud model, where they try to map. They combine the satellite data with street view, and you almost get almost like a polygonal model. Looks like it, but it's kind of
maybe we can talk later.
Yeah, I'm interested in discussing it.
Max, I have a quick question for you. Can you elaborate a little bit on how do you guys include public submissions into your releases? Do you test and you decide what goes into your release, or everything that's submitted is included in the release?
We have to. Can you maybe? I think the thing we need to do is to ensure that X Freedom stays maintainable. So if everybody would just push something, like I do my note and I do it in a super dirty way, and then I push that, and someone else does the same, then after 2 years or so, it will probably be in a state it cannot be maintained anymore, and there will be unforeseeable bugs and stuff like that. So in order to make it live a bit longer, you need to maintain it somehow. And then there need to be some people that maintain it and have a rough overview of the whole system. And say, okay, that fits in well, could you please add that and that, and then we accept it. So this is more a quality assurance or like software development thing. It's not that we don't want people to contribute, but we just have to have some mechanism. I think it's the same in 3JS. There is this guy, Ricardo Cabello, Mr. Duke, and he's just doing pull requests all the time, I think. So people do some contribution to 3JS, and he has the big picture in mind, and then he manages the contributions, and someone has to do it. And necessarily, it doesn't need to be us. So it could be also another institution. If someone would say, "Yeah, we have two or three guys, and they work half time on maintaining X Freedom, doing pull requests, cleaning up the code, maybe moving it to TypeScript because it's better for maintaining large systems and stuff like that." That would be great. I mean, we don't need to do it. It's not that we want to do the X Freedom thing on our own. So it should really be a public and open thing. And if there is someone, some lab or some institution that says we can maintain this for the next years, we have people who can do that. We can talk absolutely. It's really open. There just has to be someone who merges everything together and has some big picture. And until 2 years ago also there was one. So it's mainly me and Kimo Sturm, but I will not do it for the next 10 years for sure.
Hello everyone, I'm Alex, and I will introduce you to X Freedom with physics and how to make a record using HR. Here's the scope. We see some things, basic things about kinesiology. Then we see HR, with physics with AMOGS, and finally how to exploit HR to make a record. First, kinesiology is a study of human and animal movement. It combines many scientific fields and different. It has three major systems. The nervous system that transfers the signal from the brain to the rest of the body with the nerves. It's like the network of the body. We have the muscular system that transforms the signals and orders into motion. And finally, the skeletal system that keeps all things together. We will focus on the skeletal system here. So, as you can see, in the skeletal system we have joints and segments. So, red dots, we have the joints, replicated on the body, and with blue segments. And some attributes here about the joint, dot, the degree of freedom, the limits, and type of joint. For the segments, we have mass, length, center of mass, and inertia. Just some attributes and stuff. So, next, from this area, H-Anim. H-Anim is a standard to represent humanoids in VR in 1987. It's flexible. Can allow us to create a humanoid with a different tool and animate it with another. And it makes a lot easier to use models and serve it with other people. To make a creation of humanoids simpler, the humanoid working group developed 5 new nodes: the joint node, the segment node, the side node, the splicer node, and finally, but not least, the humanoid node. The joint node represents the joints of the body. It gives rotation and motion to segments. A joint node can only be a child of another joint node. And here, you can see some of the most common fields. The name must be always exist. The L limit is the lower joint limits for joint, and U limit the upper joint limits. Next is the segment node that is the segment represents the segment in the body. They can have shapes or transform nodes deciding to have a visual representation. And as the previous joint node, they also have a name that we always must give. They have a mass, center of mass. The side node is defined as an end effector location, or it uses for accessories if you want to put some jewelry or clothes on your model. And you can use it to make a virtual camera, like a vision through the eyes. If you add the side node in your model, you have to put a sharp fixed tip in the name. The children field is to store the accessories, and the translation defines the location of the end effector. A displacer node is to specify a group of vertices in a mesh to make a part like the eyebrows. You can give a muscular action through this. If you put it here in the name, the suffix action, like left eyebrow, up action. This means you have the vertices up, and then you have like an animation. Finally, we have the humanoid node that stores human related data. That means it's easy for the human to read. A name must be always exist for the applications identify it. We have the version. This is the version of the specification that follows the modeling of the humanoid. Now it's 1.1. Current version of H-Anim. And we have the info that includes a group of informations about the author, like the name of the author, rather, and about the model, like the height or the weight or other stuff. If you want to model your own humanoid, you have to follow some things, use a standard. You have to put it in starting position. Facing in Z plus Z, the plus Y to be up, and plus X to the left of the humanoid. You have to place it at origin 0 here, and locate it at the ground level between the feet. Here is the hierarchy and with the names, the standard names. You can not change these names because it's in the specification. With blue we have the joint, if you can watch it. And with green the segments. So to explain really, in the start we have the humanoid root, and inside it we have a segment of this sacrum, and we have three other joints, the left hip, the right hip, and sacroiliac. If you follow the path, this path, you're going to create a whole leg. Because inside the left hip you have the LP, the left knee, and it's, the other things like the ankle, the gout, the bow, the mitral, him. And here we have the sacroiliac with the rest of the body, like the pelvis with shoulders. And we can, this is a basic hierarchy, because you can make it a lot of, you can add a lot of much more things. So, next, we have some code in the extreme. So this is basically the representation of the hierarchy, but with code. Because if you see, inside we have a transform node here, and it's nested in the segment. The segment is the upper arm. The transform node is the index space with appearance and other stuff. You can add. But appears the upper arm of the human body. And inside the upper arm, you have the shoulder, the left shoulder, that includes all the others. And if you watch here, you can have another joint side with another segment and transform. So, practice, we have the code. Visually, next to this image, gives us this about bullet physics is a engine that gives us simulation. It's written in C++, and the most important is free and open source. So we have some few features about simulation called vision shapes, like collision detection and risk body dynamics. It saves like self-air, MOS, cone, cylinder, and others. But the problem with the C is we cannot use it on the web. So we have a direct port of bullet JavaScript. That is the AMO.js. So in AMO.js we have the collider shapes like sphere, box, cylinder, and constraint methods like point constraint, slider constraint, hinge constraint, point twist constraint, and others. The other JS that we're using is the bullet physics JS. That is an implementation of rigid bodies, of rigid body physics for extreme. Enables real-time physics simulation, x3D scenes. Here we have the pairing between the x3D and AMO.js. Basically, this is a constructor of AMO.js inside the AMO.js. So, if you want to make an x3D, sphere in x3D scene, you have to use it as a sphere, but in AMO.js we have the BT sphere safe, and the others go like box, cylinder, growing, but we not supported the culture, say, for example. In same logic, we have the join and constraint methods. This is the syntax in join, like this one on your elbow. We have ball join, like, and the others in the AppleJS. Here in demo one, we have a simple scene in Xfilter that we are using only rigid bodies. As you can see, you can take one, drag it, drop it, and as you can see, we have a real-time simulation of physics collisions. So the code behind this is very simple. For the visual, we have the transform node. This is basically the floor. So as you can see, it's basically floor. We can give a box size and here X, Y, Z. And then we have to put the physics. The collectible shape node takes the same attributes like from the transform. So you have the right shape for the right collision, right? So you have the collectible shape node with the shape floor. You can give the you have to give the same translation. You have to use the floor transform from the container field physics. And then you add the box size, it's the same like the transform. Then we have the rigid body, that clips the rigid body collection. Here we can give set to the gravity. Here is the -9.8. That's the gravity on the scene, you see. You have to rename it, always do. And inside the rigid body collection, you can put any rigid body you want. Basically, you have the scene. So here we can put the floor. And there is some attributes. We have the fixed that is true. If it's true, you cannot drag it with your mouse. So you can interact with your mouse directly. The mass means that if you put it at zero, then the gravity doesn't affect anything. Practically, this means that you have an immovable object. Then you use the global gravity, true. So you have all the rigid bodies with the same gravity to affect. And then you add the collectible shape that you declared before with the same with the same name as you use it. Finally, we have the collision sensor node that sends the collisions of rigid bodies. Inside the collision sensor, you have the collision collection that you can parse some attributes or behaviors of the simulation. You have to put the collectible shape so it can be run finally. And you have to always to enable it to. Here we demo 2, we have a simple same scene as before, but with a two join in the scene. So basically we have rigid bodies, and now we can have constraints like joints. as you can see here, you can click it and behaves like a join, a single axis join. So the only modification on this code is the join node. This is the input string. So inside the rigid body collection that we saw before, you can have the rigid bodies, but also you can have the constraints, like a single axis hinge joint. Here, we have to set the archon point 1, archon point 2, the max angle, and min angle. So you have to constrain. And also the axis that it will be rotating. Inside the single axis hinge joint, you have to use your body that you're using here, like the pendulum 0, pendulum 1 in this example. Next is the basic ragdoll. This is not the Italian, but you can see that it behaves like a human body with human limits, human body limits. And you can drop it everywhere you want and have the real-time here collisions. So, to make this ragdoll to work, we need to implement a new joint for the simulation of upper and of upper arm and upper leg. This is the cone twist joint. Here is the attributes for the cone twist joint. As you can see, we have the same thing like archon point 1, archon point 2, because we have two rigid bodies that connect together. We have Euler specifies the angle of body and Euler 2 specifies the angle of body too. The swing is not one of the limits, means the rotation on the z axis in degrees. And the same for y, for swing span 2 and for y and swing span for x. In order to create the ragdoll using its angle type, we can create dynamically ragdolls from file. It is more realistic, more accurate, and faster than you can make it by the hand. Here is the basic idea for the creation. You have the x3D scene, then you can find, you have to find the H time. You have to find then the locate the joints and segments of a channel and transforms to scene. So you can apply then to create the physical body like quantum shapes, rigid bodies, and finally the constraints. And this ragdoll created by this prototype, it's more realistic from other. Maybe some fixes to be done, but generally it works. You can see that they have some animations, physics, and behavior like a human being. Yeah, it's pretty cool. And maybe it looks creepy.
You have to work a lot harder than a high grade these days.
So we can support several models from HRM examples. Those examples are the if you hit HRM examples, you will find the consortium. This is actually 3D characters.
Alexander?
May I use my voice as well?
Yeah. You can pick any of it and use it. Because it's built in the HRM prototype. So you can use it directly. much more. I have also some demos if some of the students want to run it. I have these things if they want to play it. Any questions? Or?
How
did
you got these two texture maps, the faces of the program from India on the wall?
This is from. They have used several tools. Offering tools to create those characters and then apply the HTML protocol to them. So, if you allow me to show you those examples, they are already up in the HTML examples. Just maybe the results.
I may say I have an announcement while Alexandros is trying to find it. I have an announcement for the bus, for the dinner, because the dinner is outside the hotel, and so we have to catch the bus as well. So we have to be in the lobby, okay, in English, 7:45.
Really? 7:45. Okay.
So we have to be there. Something else about what Alexander presented. We haven't released that on the internet yet, so if it's something you can ask us and we will send you all the details, okay, no problem, but we haven't released on the internet yet.
So this is the site. They have several of extended scenes with any signing on other things, but it's not a signing exactly. That I used is the Korean Korean characters. They are articulated 3D game characters designed with several graphic tools and then converted to X3D HTML models. So if you go to open one, you can see the model in X3D. But it doesn't have any animation. Maybe someday.
Those are all downloadable for use in hotels, too.
So this is the
the door.
The door, yes. But can I animate the physics then? Or I can show you the HTML that I used here. That is the animated the HTML that I used in this example before, and share together in there. So yeah, you can parse the texture from the offering tool, and then you can take the texture coordinates, and you have nothing to do with that.
Just thinking, without the hair, keep doing it from here. And the beard too.
Thank you. Introduction from the tutorial chair. My name is Christian Solz from DFKI. Welcome to the tutorial Shape.js, adaptive material descriptions. So we start early and we try to be really sharp in time so you have enough time to dress up and go to the evening event. So our tutorial today is about, as the title says, about Shape.js, and we want to structure the tutorial in a way that, well, I welcome you and give a small introduction. This is Jans Sutter, my colleague from DFKI, which is the German Institute for Artificial Intelligence in Saarbrücken. I will give a introduction where I motivate why we did Shape.js and what's the idea, what's our approach. It's will be a talk about like 50 minutes or 20 minutes, and then we have really a hands-on session afterwards where we can really try to use Shape.js. Jan will do this part mainly. We thought that you might be interested in just trying it online on your computer. So we have online this Shade Studio, which is our small shader development online thing. Unfortunately, the internet is kind of slow and the application is kind of large. So if you already start downloading now, maybe it's there in like 15 minutes when I finish my presentation. Also, these slides are available online, and then I have a Google Doc document which is editable by all of you. So if you have some questions or some comments, you can, and you, of course you can ask, but if you don't dare, you can just type your questions into that document or give some comments during the tutorial. Okay, the slides are also linked from the tutorial from the Web3D Consortium page, so then we don't have to type any of these URLs now. So, what's the motivation? So, currently, if we talk about scene descriptions or scene graphs in general, which try to get a certain abstraction layer, materials is always kind of an issue. So in X3D you have a so-called Übershader, it's a material model which you can configure with a fixed set of parameters. So the standard material in X3D is very much the Lin-Fong model that was used during the fixed function pipeline, and the parameters roughly match to those of that time. So there's not much to configure, not too much to customize. You can use a diffuse texture to determine the diffuse coefficient. You can use vertex colors, but that's shininess in a little bit. But there are not many ways to customize your material. More sophisticated approach is the Common Surface Shader, which has been introduced by our colleagues from IGD. This is a much larger surface shader, which has a lot of more components to configure. So you can do normal mapping and things like this, but still you're restricted to a fixed set of parameters that you can use for this shader. But even in Cordata, the predefined materials model are very primitive, so you have just a Lambert, Fong, or Blin shading model. So you all know a little bit about shading models, about BRDFs. We go through some of them, but we won't deliver all the theoretical background of how that is done. Well, this is the one approach. If we have an abstract scene description, we want to have some abstract material, and Übershaders is in general one approach. The other approach is to use specific shaders. So you use a platform shader like GLSL, LSL, or CG. In future, there's also this low-level shading language, Sphere 5, I guess is the right pronunciation, I'm not sure.
Sphere V.
Which is a kind of unified instruction set that you can perform in your shader, a very low level. And a bunch of standards really allow to use those specific shaders. For example, in X3D you have a profile to use those specialized shaders. Also in Collada you have different profiles where you can use those specialized shaders. Or GLTF, also there is no material in GLTF, you just specify the shader that you want to use to render. So, but this has a lot of downsides, not only that you lose platform independence, it has also some other drawbacks that I will come back to later. And of course we have some offline shading languages like RenderMan Shading Language or Open Shading Language. RenderMan Shading Language is quite specific to ray tracing because you can trace arbitrary rays. It's kind of hard to implement this on a GPU. And Open Shading Language is kind of similar. We adapted some ideas from Open Shading Language in our Shade.js, mainly the closures that we will explain later. So as I said, the motivation for Shade.js is to have a shareable and portable material description which runs on multiple platforms, and that is assignable to not just one specific 3D asset, but to a large set of different assets with different properties. So if we talk about this, what does it mean? So we have some input parameters for material, which might be vertex attributes, some uniform parameters, textures, other scene parameters like transformations, and then we have hardware capabilities. So even on a GPU, the hardware capabilities may vary a lot. And our material has to adapt to these input parameters, which we also call the execution environment. On the other hand, our material should run on different platforms. We want to use maybe a game engine or a ray tracer, or just a WebGL application. So we have to adapt to those different platforms. So what we want with this material, when I talk about a material, I talk about a visual concept. We want to have conceptually equal appearance on all platforms. Of course, if we vary the lighting algorithms that we use here, we won't achieve exactly the same results. In terms of lighting, the materials will look different, but all other aspects should be as similar as possible. So what do we need for such shaders? Well, one important aspect is that we want to separate materials from other concerns. If we talk about specific shaders, like GLSL shaders, you have, for example, for DirectX9 pipeline, you have a vertex shader stage and the fragment shader stage, and they implement different aspects of the whole rendering process. So lighting starts somewhere on CPU, doing some pre-calculations, and ends in the fragment shader. The displacement is typically done on CPU or on a vertex shader. Same as the animation of parameters, for instance, for vertex attributes, is typically done on CPU and also in the vertex shader. So the fragment shader and the vertex shader, they implement different aspects of the rendering system, and we really want to separate the material aspect. On the other hand, we want to have the material description in a single place. We don't want to spread it in multiple files, so it should be just a single file in that case. And then if we look at specific shaders, they all declare really specifically their input. And there's no way to adapt that. So if I say my position is a VEC3, and it's a varying, so it's a vertex attribute, I don't have any chance to adapt this to some other signature. So I have a fixed signature in GLSL, but what we want that these materials work more like a template, and they should adapt to the input. So we don't want to declare all these parameters in the material. They should be calculated from our input. And then finally, we have to adapt to our content. And that's again something that a specific shader cannot do. You cannot write in a GLSL shader, does the vertex color exist? If it does exist, I do this and that. We don't want that in a specific shader because we don't want all these branchings and existence calls. So that's not available in those specific specialized shader languages. But we need that to really be able to adapt to the asset. Because if we want a general material, we don't know what the user will attach the material to. If it attaches the material to an asset that does not provide any vertex colors, then our material has to adapt to this. Maybe I skip to this one. The adaptation logic is normally implemented inside the application. So you have some kind of shader compositor or something that uses macros, preprocessor macros, or puts together some strings to adapt the specific shader to the current input. But of course, then this adaptation logic is baked inside the application. And if a user wants to use a material, you cannot use it because you don't have any access to the adaptation logic. This is not a big deal in games, because in games, you know your assets very well. Often the shader is part of the asset, so the asset is really intertwined with the shader. But that's exactly what we don't want. We want the material to be as independent as possible. Of course, in offline binding, another common approach is to use such shade trees where you explicitly connect the execution environment to your shader nodes. But there's an artist who really draws the connections between the execution environment and the shading process. So again, this is not what we want. So our approach is, in ChangeJS, we make this adaptation logic part of the material description, which is kind of novel. And we do not declare any types or computation frequencies. Computation frequencies is the scientific word for, do I have a parameter per vertex or uniform or maybe constant. This is the three common computation frequencies. So our idea is to, and when we try to submit this to scientific conferences, a lot of people laugh, we use JavaScript as our basis for the material description language. Why do we use JavaScript? Well, JavaScript does not explicitly type its parameters, which is perfect, so we don't have to do any declarations. And on the other hand, it's our host language. We integrated ChangeJS and XML3D JS, so we can, it's kind of natural for web developers to use JavaScript to program also the shading description. Of course, it's just a subset of JavaScript. Don't try to use any prototype chains or any exotic step or any allocation of dynamic arrays or something. It's more or less in a type of computation that's quite similar to those of GLS, for instance. And all objects that we provide, like Mac3, Mac4, they are immutable, so it's kind of easier for us to map them to GLSR. This is not a conceptual restriction, it's just because we had to implement the compiler framework, and that makes it much easier. And then we can adapt to the execution environment. We will see this in detail, so we can pass. We get into the shape function, we get the environment as a parameter, and now we can really query, do we have texture coordinates? Do we have a diffuse map, which is an instance of a texture? If that's the case, I go this branch, otherwise I go with some of the other branches. And so I have the possibility to really adapt to my input. I cannot only inspect the input parameters from the user, but also from the system. So for instance, I can look if this fwith is a functionality to heave standard dairy baits over both directions. So this is a capability that's not always available on every platform. So I can ask if this functionality is available. Really, like we do it in JavaScript, we look if we could also write, is this an instance of a function? And if fwith is a function, we could just call it. And then it's safe, we need to call it. And finally, we have an interface to the lighting system. Here we adapted those radiance closures, very similar to Open Shading Language, where you have, for instance, a diffuse color closure where you can configure the diffuse via the different parameters or font via the app, and we have a list of different predefined closures which you can call from ShadeJS. And then in the next step, we have a compiler. The compiler, by the way, is written in JavaScript as well. So the whole system runs in the browser. And the browser passes, compiler passes your ShadeJS code, as soon as you assign your material to a specific execution environment, the compiler gets gets the execution environment, the materials. We also use the same compiler framework to adapt our lighting. Because we write our lighting loops then also in ShadeJS, so we get all this adaption logic also for the light loop, but this part is not user configurable, but these parts are parts in user space. And then the compiler computes all the types, doing type inference, it eliminates all the branches that do not apply, does some constant propagations for that, and then it's then able to generate specialized shaders. Also, we have some optimizations in it, so the compiler automatically computes uniform expressions which do not change per vertex but only per geometry, and then it's much more efficient to execute the uniform expressions on the CPU, or if we have some space transformations in our code, if they are linear, we can compute them on the vertex shader, and so the compiler spreads your material to the different stages of the rendering system. And this way, I will talk about performance afterwards. To sum that up, we have this material description language, which is more adaptive and more general than previous approaches. And we have the compiler framework, which is able to specialize the material and then optimize it by spreading it to the different stages. We have output for GLSL and for open shading language. And as I said, the compiler framework is JavaScript as well. So here's some results. In terms of performance, after specialization, we got exactly the same instruction count like a shader that has been specialized using a preprocessor, despite the much higher abstraction level. On the other side, if the uniform extraction works, we can shift some operations to the CPU, which is very nice for mobile platforms where we don't have as many fragment pipelines. We got a speed up to 2.4x, which is not really an optimization in the sense of, wow, everything is faster, but this is, are things that are normally done by a shader author. A shader author would detect those uniform expressions and shift them to CPU and say, well, that's the same expression for the whole geometry. But you don't have to look into this. You can just write safely your code in just a single material description, and the compiler will automatically do this split up. Here's some results. So here we have 9 materials that we described with Shape.js. And here we apply XML3D format shading, but we can use the same code to also generate a default shading pipeline where we just write the closure parameters in gbuffers that we use then in the second pass to compute the line. We can use the same descriptions then to render this with cycles using the open shading language. And there we can do ray tracing, but we can also do some global illumination using the cycles path tracing. And as you can see, conceptually, we have really the same materials. Of course, if we see here global illumination, we have all this color bleeding, and we have much better reflections than in the WebGL pipeline. But in the end, we have at least conceptually the same materials. Okay. Maybe a little bit for future work. We want to use the same approach also, for example, for lights. Here we have more or less the same issues. Lights are not that important because the standard light models are sufficient in many cases, but also to integrate multi-pass techniques into Shape.js. And I have to say some thanks to those who financed my trip to Creta. So thanks, and here I pass over to Jan, who will go now into the details, and I hope you will have some fun hacking some Shape.js shaders. Thanks.
So, oh, yes, it was.
So I hope some of you could got access to the Shape Studio. I see at least one instance running over there. So, and one over there. So that's nice. So this is our little here development environment for Shape.js shaders. All the tutorials we will go through are selectable here, so you can press on any one and see result like this. So, but we will start with the first one. And we start with a simple flat shading in white. So, pretty simple. So, I guess the next thing would be to get access to some parameters like color. So as Christian already told you, we have something called the environment, which is the first parameter that is passed into the shape function. So we start by naming that. We usually call it N for environment, but go ahead with everything you want. And we then can simply return, for instance, a color. So, but there is no color, so we have to go to the input panel and create a parameter, which usually is a float free. So I name that color. And black is not very useful, so let's get some RGB and use some orange. And now you see we have at least a single parameter and can access it through the environment. And as Christian already told you, we do not differentiate between the different computation rates. So this is now a uniform parameter, so it's constant over the whole object. But if we have an object, and over there is the assets selection, there is one which has a color attribute, which is a per vertex attribute, which means it changes per vertex. And this one has a higher priority than the uniform parameter. So if you have this shader and you apply it to an object with a per vertex color, it uses the per vertex color. If you choose an object that doesn't have one, but there is a uniform color, it uses that. So that's the priority there.
So is there a kind of list of these are kind of preserved names? So there are conventions. Is there a list of these names?
What do you mean by convention? So yeah. That this one is called color is arbitrary. So I could call it color 2. If then the object provides data that is called color 2, it will work equally.
Okay.
So in XML 3D, what maybe to say you could integrate Shape.js in any rendering system. But in Shape.js we have this generic attribute, so you can have arbitrary vertex attributes and you can have arbitrary uniform parameters defined. So that just maps to the names.
Okay, so there's no texture on the object, it's attribute.
Yes, it was just the normal turned into color in that case. But you can use any color you want. Okay, so flash heading is pretty boring, so let's use some like code diffuse. So we always pass the color as the first parameter to our color closures, therefore the name. And the second one is the norm for diffuse. And all the objects, the assets in here, have norm called normal. And there you go. You have diffuse shading, aka Lambert, here there.
Is there just a question, because some of us get this.
Yeah, you need to wait for a moment. It's just a huge environment texture that's probably some.
And everybody's loading it.
At the same time from the book to here. So.
Okay, so now we got pretty simple Lambert diffuse shading. One thing that is pretty nice about Shape.js is that due to the adaption logic, we also have default parameters. And this closure, for example, has a third parameter, which is a roughness parameter, which turns the BRDF into an RNA BRDF. So some of you have heard maybe of that BRDF. And what's nice is that if you remove that, you will really only get the cosine weighted diffuse BRDF. No additional computation, there is no branching. This only happens if you add the parameter, then you get a pretty heavy computation, pretty heavy computation for the RNA VLF. Okay, so this was the beginning for the shading. So we can also do linear combinations. So let's add maybe a form. So let's say we have a specular color, pass in the normal again, and maybe a third, let's call it shininess. I should break the line here. And we can add the parameters. So set 10. And a new color, the specular color I used. Okay. And let's make it plastic, so we'll use some whitish color. And as you see, now you have specular highlights following the form you have on top of the already existing member. Okay, I can see some screens and you can follow.
Could you go back to the source code?
sorry, yes, of course. You will have the source available there. It should be tutorial 2.2. I know, tutorial 2.3, but with different colors.
Does that also create the input?
Yes, the inputs are here.
Ah, yeah.
So, you can just play around. You don't have to type. unprotected.
So when the input type does not match, for example, for shininess, I choose vector, just to see what happens. And then I just have a red bar on the bottom, but no error message.
Okay.
Because of the loading, or?
We have currently we have some optimization, so we do not loop apply the light loop per closure, but we merge both operations. And so if you apply some failures directly inside the diffuse call, the compiler doesn't produce really good error messages currently. If you do this a line above and assign the, no, that doesn't work. But you can use whistle, so if you use a dot x function, then also your touch will work.
Okay.
So we have...
maybe I can just show some swizzles. So for example, if you have a back 3 like the normal, you can just use typical GLSL style swizzles like this to create a new vector of 3 components using the x, y, and z component of this vector. But we can also use double xc, so it's a pretty strange pattern, but you can do whatever you want there. Triple x, I don't know if this will... Yeah. Okay, so as you know from GLSL, just keep in mind that we use the function or method call syntax, so this won't work or will produce strange things, so use the methods. Okay, so this was the form model. We have, as these things are built into the language or into the frameworks. There are no user definable closures, so we got some predefined ones, typical models that should be well known. There's, for instance, a concurrence model, which is a microfaceted BRF. This is known to anyone of you. So microfaceted BRFs are just consider tiny bumps on the surface that affect how light reflects, and also introduces things like masking or small structure that hides the reflection from other structures, so you get some shadowing into the BRF. Just for the parameters, it's again color, the normal. This is the normal incidence reflection because the model uses a Fresnel tail internally. So this is for our approximation, the intensity of the reflection if you look exactly down the normal of the surface. And then we have a roughness parameter that works similar to the roughness of the diffuse over here. So some people like to synchronize those, but I chose different parameters just to play around with them. So if you increase the roughness here, you can see how the highlight spreads. Or if you reduce the normal incidence reflection, see how the reflection diminishes where you look at the object, but as soon as you turn the camera towards a higher angle between normal and the U vector, you will get a brighter highlight due to the Fresnel term. So then we have an anisotropic highlighting, BIRDF, which is the WAD, which is pretty standard model to model anisotropic reflection on surfaces. So for those who don't know what anisotropic reflection is, it pretty much means that if you have a surface and a light source, then an isotropic surface usually reflects, doesn't change its reflection if you turn it around under the light source. Anisotropic reflection does change if you turn it underneath the light source. So typical example is a CD. If you turn a CD, you get anisotropic reflections. Or a crushed metal, crushed aluminum is usually anisotropic. And then we have typical reflect and refracting closure. But as you see, you cannot look through the object on the platform because this is typically done using cube maps. So the environment you have is a simple cube map, or in this case, a latitude-longitude 2D map, which would do a ray lookup for the reflected and refracted ray in order to produce that result. But if you would now compile this to, let's say, open shading language, you could use the full ray tracing, path tracing mechanics to get real reflection and real refraction. So this is just the implementation for real time because you cannot do ray tracing. So next is transparency, which is pretty simple. It's transparent, and then you get the alpha value. As transparency is always problematic, it's one means opaque in our case, and zero means completely transparent. So yeah, it's just convention. You always get it wrong. I've chosen this one. I don't know why. It was just the first guy. And the next thing would be discarding of pixels. So if you just return undefined, which is the default value, if you just return in JavaScript, you discard the pixel. So if we look, it's more or less how the object is discarded. And if you take the slice parameter, you can see you can increase or decrease that depending on the position on the x-axis. Or if you want the y-axis. Or see how you like. Okay, so these are all the closures we have. I think they are quite complete to make it possible to write pretty nice materials. Even layered materials like paint. Question?
I was just wondering, so I can use multiple instances and then add them together?
Yeah, they are just a linear combination.
There's also a shade mix where you can have
a parameter.
Yeah.
And what about vertex shading?
work exchangers are not concerned in JJS. So they are automatically generated depending on what attributes you use and whatnot. And
so you have a tutorial about changing vertices?
You mean vertices changing?
The position of the vertices.
Well, in XML3D we have a separate system for the animation of vertex positions, where we have a data flow graph where you can do arbitrary data processing, and you can also process the attributes like position or other attributes.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have it with us, but we have the first small examples where really the XFlow generates the vertex shader, and the ShadeJS generates the vertex shader plus the parts of the vertex shader that you require for the material.
Mm-hmm.
And so both system, because the material has nothing to do with the displacement or the animation, and the animation should be described in a separate logical distinct feature, should be in a separate system. And then they together compile the complete pipeline. For
okay. Yeah, I was not only thinking about animation, but also maybe you think maybe also part of the material. You have just did a modification to the vertices, but okay, it's not included yet.
Yeah, that's something we discussed. If displacement might be something that's also nice to describe within the material, but for now we said let's keep it with the shading.
Okay. For example, if I think of water, so flowing water. It would be nice to have a vertex shader also.
Yeah, but especially for that's our typical use case for the XFlow system. So if you want to really displace your geometry based on water,
okay.
You can easily either really manipulate the positions or manipulate the incoming normal, which is then used for the shading. So also that's really a separate system.
Yeah, I have a question. It's a pretty cool system. I toyed around with it and accidentally created some kind of layered material that looks sweet. For the reflections, there's the tutorial with the refraction.
Mm-hmm.
I basically removed the refraction part and ended up with the regular, highly specular reflection. Is there a way in microfacet models? These days you usually have these pre-filtered environment maps where you can say, well, I have this microfacet distribution and I important sample that to get a rougher look. Is there a way to get access to or to transmit that? Because I tried to combine it, but it's now a linear combination rather than taking the environment map and using that as incoming light source.
Currently, none. Because we just don't have a system variable that gives access to that. But this is pretty much because we have some ideas how to implement a more generalized lighting based on environment maps or based on images. So like this pre-filtering, which is a pretty good example, I would like to have it really inside the shader. Nothing pre-computed. I would really like to just maybe we do this interactive. So maybe it would just you have your environment like, and now you would have sample function, and because we're in Java, we can do something like that. And now you do your filter.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what I imagine to be at least a possible solution to that problem. So. I
then the, maybe to add, then the compiler would detect that you don't that the function is not dependent on some vertex attribute,
right.
And can once do a pre-rendering of the generating the well, you could imagine different like noise function creating a texture,
yeah.
Or something creates one texture and on the GPU and then the resulting shader would just access the texture.
Yeah. So. In a I think that's a similar way that common game engines like Unreal and Unity have these both these procedural textures that they generate, but they do it on the CPU rather than GPU.
Okay. So to make it short again, no.
Okay.
use shading. So next thing I would like to do is to add a texture to the materials. So let's maybe start this time with the input. So we can choose texture from here, give it a name, use texture. And you can load textures from your hard drive. Just click on the texture and you should get a file dialog where you can choose a texture. There. So keep in mind they have to be compatible with the browser, check like TNG, GIF, or whatever your browser does can read. And let's choose one. So we can now access it through Diffuse Texture as the name of the parameter. So if we want, we can just do a lookup. Text coordinates are called text coord. And now we use swizzles because sampling the texture will reduce the result in a 4-component vector, and our color is typically a 3-component vector. So we swizzle and use the color, and there we have a texture. So, and I would now like to start to adapt the material or to create some adaption logic, which is the meat of JJS. So, first of all, I think we should use the default color. So, we just say, okay, if there's nothing, we create a new vector3 and use some 8% white. Okay. And now let's see if there is a diffuse texture. We take color to be the sample value. So same result as before, but now this drop-down menu contains all the parameters the shader gets from the inputs you define, and you can toggle them just to see what happens with your material if the input is not available anymore. And if I now remove the diffuse texture, it will be 8% gray because that's the default value I've chosen. And we can also say, okay, maybe we want a different uniform color, so we can combine that and say, okay, let's see if there is a color. We will use that. And if there is a color, but also the diffuse texture, we will still use the diffuse texture because it's most likely a gray or key.
I have a question or maybe feature request.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's possible at all, but I really like this way that you can do the OR and then just write your variants and say, okay, in that order, check all of those and take the first one at work. But you can probably not write OR env.diffuseTexture.sample2D if diffuse texture is not defined. So you have to do an explicit if.
Oh, you mean something like an optional that you only call sample2D if diffuse texture is actually available?
Yeah.
Okay.
Does it work? Do you try it out?
No.
Should work.
Really?
I'm not 100% sure what you meant.
But the thing is, I think what he's aiming at is that you have to check first for a diffuse texture and then you can sample it. So that would be, you would have two statements rather than one. So your color variable would end up being the diffuse texture rather than the sample.
Mm. Yeah, so I mean, it's
well, all these OR or also the conditional operator, they should work. If they don't, it's just a bug.
Oh, but it looks, is it working?
Yeah, but now you don't have to check if the diffuse texture exists. You just sample it.
And it's it's the wrong way around. Okay. So
I think he's trying to abuse the language.
No, but that would be really cool because it's not possible in JavaScript, obviously. And then if you have a
It's not possible. I'm not sure what.
But I think it's working. It's really really cool. So what I just wrote is color equals and then env dot diffuse texture dot sample b and the rest of the line.
Yeah, but turn off your texture. I don't think it will work if you turn off the
texture.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Oh yeah, you're right. Because it's
so you can use.
I cannot
do it.
Okay. Actually, it's not working.
So it's possible to use ternary operator. So you can write it.
Yeah, but then it's not. I mean, it would be really cool if you would have something dot something dot something, and if something in the middle does not exist, it would just say, okay, the expression is undefined. That would be cool, but you know, it's also not possible in JavaScript, but it would be very elegant, and you wouldn't have these ifs, you would put each of them in a new line, and indent them, and it would look really clean and neat.
What we did is intentionally in the compiler we could have done everything. We could have overloaded operators, which is often really handy in shader languages, but we really said let's really stick to the JavaScript functionality.
Yeah.
So also for the uniform expression, if we extract some expression here, it's just pure JavaScript and we can execute it on the CPU as is without any transformations. And this way, and also something we want to look into the future as well, you could execute this thing completely in software. So if you think about shader debugging or things like this, you can really have a breakpoint in your shader code or something. So we said, we had some ideas for cool features and make it more concise even, but we said let's stick to valid JavaScript.
Yeah, it would be a subset.
How would I integrate shadow? So I'm not very familiar with X3D shadow management, but suppose I have an own engine with some depth map, texture. How would I integrate shadow?
So it's barely visible, but there is a shadow actually on the platform.
On the platform, but not on the material.
So you mean, the shadow will actually be included in the lighting. So you just describe the material.
Mm-hmm.
And
it means to bake it in the material.
No, not bake, but okay. So shadow is not part of the shader.
Not part of the material,
yes.
It's part of the lighting. So we can do all the lighting, we can do shadow maps inside the light blue. So we have multi-pass rendering, we don't have it activated here, but you might have seen it in the examples. We can use screens based on the occlusion, because we can do everything in the background which concerns the lighting.
Mm. So would it be possible to have a shadow on the material?
Yes. Yes, if there was something including now, it would produce the shadow, given our very primitive shadow mapping algorithm.
So maybe it helps if we just switch to the generated GLSLR for the compiler over here. And here you see what the language generates. It might be on the HTML layer, but never mind. So here you see the light loop down here. It's pretty long. So, and this is actually, this whole light loop is behind this color closure thing. So I cannot. Okay, that's my HTML layout, sorry. Is that open?
No, we have to.
So, what you've seen, this whole cascade of for loops and so on. This is all hidden behind this statement. And this is depending on the implementation. So if you use XML3D, you will have a different rendering, a different light integration than if you use ray tracing, or if you use path tracing, or if you use X3DOM. They will probably have a different lighting implementation than XML3D. So this is system dependent.
So I need to write an adapter for my system.
You have to, if you want to integrate JHS in your system, you have to provide such a lighting integration implementation.
Maybe you can try that if you do that in the vertex shader fancy thing, like concatenating the pop buffers or the SRG. No one will break this because this is the user space code. It's safe to write your material, but you don't break any other fancy stuff you might do in the vertex shader.
So, did use texture. We checked if it exists and use it only if it's there. But we actually also have to check for the existence of text coordinates, because if we have a model that doesn't have texture coordinates, we cannot sample the texture even if it's there. So we can just use Boolean operations in our condition. So again, if we turn off the diffuse texture, we get the color. And also, if you choose an asset that doesn't have texture coordinates, like this one, we will also get only the color, because no text coordinates exist for this asset. Okay, this should be tutorial 3.4. One thing that I did there additionally is to check actually if what we have as a diffuse texture is actually a texture, because this is a parameter that is supplied by the user or through the asset or somewhere else. It may happen that it's not a texture. Just call it diffuse texture. So if we would try to sample it, we would get strange results or simply an error. So you go over here and just try to call diffuse texture now flow 3. You will see it will just use the color, because we've checked here if diffuse texture actually has a sample 2D function, which pretty much identifies that as a texture. So we could also use instance of or something like that in JavaScript, so but we use the duck typing approach to check this texture. So the next thing is 4.1, we have prepared a normal mapping shader with the predefined normal map. And I would now like to create a shader that can do normal mapping and anisotropic highlight on a model without any attributes, and can adapt to all the variants that exist on the possible attributes of the model and supplied input parameters. So the first thing is, again, we check for the normal map, if it exists. And only do the normal mapping if it's there. So same as before, we just check if there is a parameter called normal map. I will not test if it's a texture, I would just assume it is. And if the normal map exists, we sample it doing the standard normal mapping algorithm in intention space, and then use that on for the shading. And if no normal map is there, we just use the object norm that is supplied to the asset. And then again, we can also check if there is if the object actually has text force. Text form, sorry. And if it has, we sample the normal map. If it doesn't have text form, in that case, it doesn't even have a tangent. So, we have to actually try to handle the case when there is no tangent on the model. So, we also have to check if there is a tangent. We simply use it, and now we fake one. So I usually go for something like this to fake my tangents. It's pretty simple, but useful actually, quite good results. Otherwise. And if it has a tangent, we use it. If it doesn't have a tangent, we just use some arbitrary vector to cross product with the normal and use that as a tangent. So now we can assure that there is definitely a tangent, so we can do our tangent space normal mapping. And we could actually also do the same for the normal. So maybe what happens if there is no normal? So give it if it's there, and if not, we simply use some screen space normal. It's then just the face normal, but at least there is a normal, and at least we get some shading. So we will now use from the position.
So you know,
just
derivatives.
That's ddx and ddy in GLSL.
Yes,
yes,
yes, yes.
So here we get the deviation of the position, and so we can see how the position changes over the surface, and this way we can approximate a normal along the surface. Actually, we should check if the dx and dy functionality is available, because the standard derivatives are only available on via extension in WebGL.
Yeah, but now you got me.
Okay.
If it's not available and we have no normal, then the shader will not combine. So then, yeah. But I guess it can handle quite some cases right now. So. Let's see if we can return off the normal map. We have this. Maybe let's see what happens if we only have the normal. Okay, no text cards. We use this. So now the only thing that is left is actually the text cards. So maybe we can generate them too using some spherical mapping. So. Coming.
object to be able to accept not just the scalars but also the our vectors. So in the end, you get the same, and we extended it also by some functions. So in the end, you get the same standard functionality like in the GLSL standard library.
The scope of the variables is transported outside. They're not scoped, the variables.
No.
All right.
It's just like JavaScript. So you can do multiple declarations of the same variable. They will be combined and hoisted to the top.
Okay.
So that would be the next step to also support closures. Because, for instance, now we have in some of the closures, we have the finality town somehow configured, and we would really like to give into the mix function something, the finality town as a closure again, that you can configure, but in the end, you do not access or explicitly give a direction or something, because the whole code should be independent of. So, and we now have actually, you have to believe me on that, asset that has nothing except for position attribute. And it runs the same shader as the asset that has text scores, norms, and tangents. It's a different model, actually, this. It looks different, but conceptually it should look the same. And in that case, you at least have a conceptual normal mapping, and maybe it's good enough for an object that is far away from the viewer, but at least it doesn't use errors if you just share that material with your colleague that attaches it to some asset and everything breaks. This is the worst case. So with this one, you can just share it, use any asset you have, and at least get some result. And then you can look, okay, maybe I should get some normals on my models, which is actually often a good idea to have normals on your models. So this tutorial should be on the 4.3 with some extensions to it. So this is the final thing. It has the normal mapping. It has 3D views textures that are combined.
This is somewhere here on the checks in it. So if there is some black fiber texture, then this is used. If there's a white fiber, we use it. And if there's a masking texture, we use that. And finally mix it. So we get this carbon style pattern, carbon fiber style pattern. We use some textures. You can put them up here. So this is the white texture you see over here, the black fibers, and the masking, which just defines when to use which texture and how to interpolate them. And it has quite some parameters, but it actually is pretty adaptive. So maybe we just remove the white fiber texture. It's just an obvious diffuse color to see that it's missing, but we can handle that. But maybe we can remove the mask. Okay, then it's just a simple linear interpolation because I used the default value of 0.5 for the mixing. But we can handle that. And actually we can handle a material that has no attributes at all. So we can apply them. And I think this, okay, the sphere mapping, maybe not the best texture projection method for this object, but in fact, it looks pretty close to this one, from the concept of the material. And this really is an object that has nothing except for positions and an index one. Are there any questions regarding this quite complex shader and the adaption? I think the adaption logic is quite natural if you are used to JavaScript programming, because this is what we usually do. We check for the existence of a parameter. If it's not there, we use a default value. If it's there, we use that. So I think if you're used to JavaScript or web developer, this flows quite naturally. Then I will hand over again to Kristen for the last couple of minutes to actually take a real shader from ShaderToy and adapt it to Shade.js. So, more like hacking.
I hope I will succeed. So. Okay, thank you. I'll try to keep in time. Maybe before we do that, a little also nice use case for shading is here. The shader you see, you don't see anything special, but you see here's an adaption logic. The shader does something if we have barycentric coordinates. I don't know if you know what those coordinates are. It's kind of simple. You just assign to a triangle vertex attributes, and for each vertex you assign a different vector with those numbers varying, and this way you can, from the interpolated value that you receive in the vertex shader, you can see how close you are to the edges, for example, and things like this. And we have now we use a model that that has those centric coordinates assigned. And this way, what we do here, I have false here, so we are in this code here. Now I can see if the if any of these centric coordinates is below a certain epsilon. And if it's below this epsilon, I reduce the diffuse color a little and use an emissive, really wet color, maybe not so nice visually, to render the edges of the triangles. And if I and as you can see now, it looks kind of nice, but it still has a lot of anti-aliasing. And again, we can use the standard derivatives to better estimate how far are we actually away from the edge of the triangle by seeing how much the value relatively changed.
So, and then if I activate this because I have this functionality available on my computer, you can see that the edges are much nicer than before. And I could also do something like so if I just do not shade it, just return, I can discard all the faces and just to render the lines that are close. Or we don't render lines actually. We render those fragments which are close to the edge of the surface, which is a standard shading thing to render wireframe in a more recent OpenGL version without geometry shaders where it's really trivial. But in geometry shaders you could also generate the spiral center coordinates without delivering them as a vertex attribute, but without an additional rendering pass. As Jan already mentioned, I will try to, I think all of you know ShaderToy, which is a kind of platform where you can hack GLSM shaders. And I will try now to, what's wrong here? I will try now to translate a ShaderToy shader, and you will just see what you need to do if you see a nice ShaderToy shader, how it kind of relates latest to Shade.js. So it's not too difficult, it's a little bit annoying to do that, but you see, the first pass is that you get a lot of syntax errors. So we have an unexpected identifier here. So there is no void in JavaScript. So I just have a function, and I pass in here the result. It's a fragment color. I have an out function here, so I just get the coordinates in, and I return the color here. So. First part. Now I need to get rid of all these explicit type stuff. So what I do is I just replace all the typing through a var. We don't care about types. The compiler will compute all types for me. So it's a little bit more like the auto. In the end, we need types, so it will be an error if the compiler cannot compute a type, or if a type is heavily polymorphic and we cannot resolve it. But now you see we have eliminated all syntax errors, but we didn't use the function, so there's still a lot of things going wrong there. So now I want to call the function, for example, my text chords. This is normally what we have in ShaderToy to get the position on the image plane. I just use the frag chord, this case here, just to highlight that this is a VEC2. Now it will complain that I didn't close my function here. And now we don't have a global time here. I will use 10 for now. Opposed to GLSL, we do not care. GLSL is really picky if you don't use this float identifier that you have, really have a float. We assume an int as long as you don't use the variable as a float, which is a typical behavior of a JavaScript interpreter. And this way, you don't have to care about these, if I write 0 or 0.0 to identify this as a float value instead of an int value. So we have to adapt these vectors, and we don't have operator overloading, so we use mol. No, this was add, I guess. And this way I go through the whole code. Here I need to find two. Okay, now we have the difference that the swizzles are functions and not properties. We might change this because sometimes it's annoying and doesn't bring in any additional value. So we can easily implement this as properties in JavaScript. So it would be legal to have this in JavaScript as well. And same here. Compiler gives you always a kind of good hint what's going on. And here we have set dot set nowadays.
So even if a poor Christian has to translate it by himself, you have an already translated version in your tutorial.
Why do I do this? By the way,
it's just a demonstration
it's
pretty simple to convert existing GLSL shaders to Shade.js. Despite the differences in syntax, using methods with link, properties with link, it's actually pretty fast to get a shader up and running in Shade.js.
Now I'm lost.
What's wrong? Anyone?
I think it's the opera. Is it? Oh, I don't know.
A special parameter called time, so if we get which we can animate, so if we replace this with time, well, I think we have to we have an animated shader here, which is we compared this what's in the paper, which is in terms of instruction count really equal to the one that's generated by the shader. Okay, I think that's so far. We have 10 minutes square time. So if you have any questions, we are looking forward for any feedback if you try it or if you get any issues. We still want to polish it a little bit and get more features into the system. Yeah, and that lets us finish this 10 minutes earlier so everyone can dress up for the evening. Thank you.
Is this online available?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the Shade.js is on GitHub, and the Shade Studio is currently not on GitHub, but on the XML page.